Hi guys, my name is Mansi Anand and I extend a warm welcome to you all. So guys, this is RBI 247 where we discuss some concepts which can be of real use to you if you are preparing for competitive exams, right? So guys, in this session, we are not going to discuss any questions, but we'll try to discuss one news which can be of use to you. And I'm sure most of you would have heard about it. And let's see what is the topic. Okay, the topic for today is India under US watch list. But before proceeding with this session, guys, I would like to ask you to subscribe to our channel. So if it is the first video of our channel that you are watching, then do not forget to hit the subscribe button. And you can also press this bell icon. It can help you to get notified whenever a new video comes up. Apart from that, you can also join our Telegram group to clear all your doubts and queries. So now, beginning with the session. So what is the news all about? See, US has put India on a watch list. I hope the screen is visible. Okay. So US has put India on a watch list, on a monitoring list. What is this monitoring list? So it's just as a teacher prepares a list of naughty students in a class, similarly, US prepares a list called monitoring list, and in that list it puts all the countries which it doubts that they are going to indulge in currency manipulation, right? So that means US is accusing India of currency manipulation, although it has not titled India as a manipulator. But it is doubting that India is doing something to its currency which is not right and ethical, right? So US is questioning India's foreign exchange policies. So this is not the first time India has been included in this watch list, in this monitoring list of US. It was included in October 2018, but after that it was removed in 2019, right? And see, one of the major country which has been branded as a currency manipulator, guys, don't worry about these terms because we are going to learn the meaning of all these terms like manipulation, manipulator, right? So don't worry about them. I'm just telling you an overview that what is in the news. So the country which has been branded by US as a currency manipulator has been China, but recently US has become stricter on many other countries, right? So China, it said China is a manipulator, but then removed that tag from China as well when the two countries reached a phase one trade deal. So basically, you know that US and China, they were engaged in some sort of trade war. They were accusing each other of hampering each other's trade, right? But when they struck the deal, then US removed China from the US took away this tag of currency manipulator from China. Now let us try to probe this event in a little detail. Okay, first of all, let us see who else is on the list. So other countries which have been labeled as manipulator by US are Switzerland and Vietnam. So guys, Vietnam is one country who is competing India in exports, in manufacturing. So it's a small country, it's not a big country, but it is one of the competitors of India, like Bangladesh. So if you remember, we have heard about Vietnam as well before, right? So US Treasury said monitoring list of countries has hit the number 10, which includes Taiwan, Thailand and India. So other countries on the list are these. You can see the names. So the report also describes that what is the meaning of this manipulator and which countries are put in this list. Basically, the countries whose central bank intervene too much in the foreign exchange market, or they try to manipulate the value of their currency by selling or buying foreign exchange, those countries who are trying to take a trade advantage by indulging into this practice, they are put into this list of manipulators, right? So India has not been branded as a manipulator, but it has been put on a watch list, and these other countries, 10 countries, have been put on a watch list or a monitoring list, right? Simple enough. Moving ahead, Okay. Now, how does a country manipulate its currency? First of all, what is manipulation? Manipulation is basically just trying to move the value of your currency. If you want to increase it or if you want to decrease it in relation to other currencies. So, if we take a relationship, let's say $1 is equals to rupees 70. So, that means if you have to buy any Indian commodity, any commodity which is valued rupees 70, you would have to give $1. And similarly, if there is a commodity which is valued rupees 140, you would have to give $2. And if an Indian wants to buy something which is denominated in dollar, let's say you go to America and you want to buy something which has a value of $2, then for buying, basically you want to make payment in dollars, and for fulfilling the value of this $2, you will have to pay 70 rupees per dollar, and for $2, it means 140 rupees, right? So this is basically an exchange rate. Now so people like you and me, we cannot have much impact on this exchange rate, but what changes the value of this exchange rate is the action of investors, especially institutional investors who invest into other countries, right? And also apart from that, government entities and central banks are also major players. They buy and hold foreign currency, they buy and sell their own currencies. So central banks, if they want to move this value up or down, then if they buy or sell currency, then it is known as currency manipulation. So policy used by governments to gain an unfair competitive advantage, right? Here you can see an example. Currency X, which is selling its own currency. I hope the diagram is visible. Okay. So there is a country called X. Who sells its currencies, its own currency, right? So it is selling its own currency in the market and buying foreign currency in return, right? So buying foreign currency in return, usually US dollars, considering how it is the international currency. Now, what is going to be the impact on it? The currency of X country is going to go down in value, whereas dollar is going to move up. Right. So this might seem like that this is a disadvantage for X and a positive for dollars. So if countries are putting a downward pressure or a downward, they are tending to downward movement of their currency, why is US so furious? Right. Because it is leading to appreciation of dollar, or it is leading to dollar becoming more powerful. The reason behind this we are going to study in next slide. So why do countries, they want their currencies to be weaker? There has to be some reason that why US is furious. The simple reason why any country would want to make their currencies weaker in relation to dollar is because they want to increase their exports. How can they increase their exports? Because if the value of their currency is going to go down, lesser dollars would be required to buy one Indian rupee. Right here, so we just studied a relation that $1 is equals to rupees 70. Right now, if India puts pressure on, downward pressure on Indian rupee, that means it depreciates, let's say it depreciates to rupees 75. Now you see that Indian currency has become weaker, but how is India benefiting from it? Because Indian currency has become cheaper in relation to dollars. Now anyone who wanted to exchange $1, earlier they used to get 70 rupees, now they are going to get 75 rupees. Basically, Indian goods are becoming cheaper to foreign residents. That is why whenever a country's currency depreciates, their goods become cheaper to the foreign customers, right? And if they become cheaper, then obviously those customers are going to demand more of that particular good. Now, in this relationship, since India's rupee has depreciated, as you can see earlier, if you wanted to buy $1, you had to spend 70 rupees. Now you're going to spend 75 rupees. That means dollar has become more expensive, a very simple transaction, right? So dollar has become expensive, rupee has become cheaper. So for an American Indian goods have become cheaper. And if Indian goods become cheaper, they are going to buy more of Indian goods and they might buy less of their own currency's goods, which is going to harm the manufacturers in US and benefit the manufacturers or exporters in India, right? So this is one foremost reason why any country would like to put a downward pressure on their currency. So there is one country which is like super popular for keeping its currency artificially depreciated. That is obviously China. I think we have learned about this a lot, that how China keeps its currencies depreciated artificially, because they do not want to lose their tag as the world's exporter, right? So if China would allow its currency to raise in value or to appreciate, its goods are going to become expensive and its exports might reduce, right? So this is one foremost reason. Competitive on international trade, weaker currencies make countries competitive on international trade front. Lower currency makes countries exports more attractive, they are cheaper in international market, right? Now, one more reason is here, weaker currency alleviates pressure on a country's sovereign debt obligations. Now, if a country, let's say there is India, and India has raised some debts in dollar currency. So, dollar has become more powerful in relation to Indian rupee. Now, if India has raised some money or raised some debt in dollars, then it is going to benefit because it has raised the debt in a stronger currency, then its debt payments are going to become lesser in value, right? See, guys, this point is valid only when the borrowing country has raised the debt in foreign currency or the currency which has become stronger in value, right? So you can see, after issuing offshore debt, so India, let's say India has raised some debt in some foreign currency, country will make payments. And as these payments are denominated in the offshore currency, a weak local currency effectively decreases the debt payment. So if they have raised debt in terms of dollars and their own currency weakens, then it benefits them. But had they raised their debt in Indian currency or in the domestic currency or in the currency which has become weaker, then their debt would rise. So for a country which has raised debt in foreign currency, it might want to depreciate its own currency. Right? So these are two foremost reasons why countries want to put downward pressure on their currency. Now, what is meant by a currency manipulator in terms of US? So basically, currency manipulator is nothing but it is a term or it is a label which is given by the US government to all those countries it feels are engaging in unfair currency practices. That means they are deliberately selling their own currency. Sorry. So these countries, which US thinks as currency manipulators, they are deliberately selling their own currency and buying foreign exchange in order to build up their foreign exchange reserves and put downward pressure on their currencies. Right, so deliberately devaluing their currency against dollar, which harms the domestic manufacturers in US. Practice would mean country in question is artificially lowering their values to gain unfair advantage. Because the devaluation would reduce the cost of exports, I think we have discussed all of it, artificially show a reduction of trade deficit. So India was last included in the watch list but removed in May 2019, right? Now, what are the parameters used? How does US know that one country is a manipulator or not? Or should it be put on monitoring list or not? So these are the three parameters that they used, right? So first parameter is a significant bilateral trade surplus with US, one that is at least $20 billion over a 12-month period. That means one country which is having a trade surplus. Trade surplus means a country which is sending or selling more goods to US than it is buying from it. Right. So basically exporting more goods to US and importing less. So if the difference between this export and import is at least $20, that means the exports of the manipulator country increases by at least $20 billion in a 1 year period, then they might be put into this category. So this is one of the conditions. The second condition, material current account surplus equivalent to at least 2% of GDP over a 12% period, right? So current account surplus should be at least 2% of the GDP. So current account surplus, moving ahead. Persistent one-sided intervention. So this is one of the most important points, which is at least very important in this particular case. Intervention by the central banks of the country. Net purchases of foreign currency. That means the manipulator country's central bank is buying a lot of foreign exchange and selling their own currency. At least 2%. So their purchases of foreign exchange should be at least 2% of the country's GDP over a 12-month period. Of that particular country's GDP, 2%, right? So if the central bank buys more foreign currency, then equivalent. So if the central bank buys at least 2% or more than it of GDP in 1 year and conducted repeatedly in at least 6 out of 12 months, that means the central bank is frequently buying foreign exchange, and that actually totals to about 2% in 1 year period, then they might be put on the list, right? So an economy meeting two of the three criteria. So three criteria specified. If an economy meets two out of three, it is placed on the monitoring list, right? So India has also violated these parameters. That is why it is put on the monitoring list. The administration also add and retain on the monitoring list any major trading US partner. See, this is one more condition by US, that US administration might put any of US's trading partner on the list, then accounts for a large and disproportionate share of the overall US trade deficit, even if that economy has not met two of the three criteria. See, this is a very simple point which says that one country which has a very large share of US's trade deficit, that means US is owing a lot to that particular country, then it might be put on this monitoring list even if it doesn't follow these three parameters, right? So these are the parameters which are used by US. Okay, now why is India on the list? India is on the list because India breached the first and third condition. Here you can see some statistics. These three conditions, India breached first and third. As you can see, India for several years has maintained a significant goods trade surplus with US. A total $22 billion in the four quarters through June 2020. These are just statistics, guys. I think you can read them on your own. And second thing, net purchase of foreign currency added to 2.4% of GDP, right? So breaching the third condition. But see, here we are only listening to the US's side of story, that this particular country is manipulating and central banks are intervening too much. But there must be some story to the other side as well, right? So why are these countries manipulating? These are the emerging economies, right? Most of them which are put on the list are emerging economies. See, these countries or our central bank RBI has the reason behind doing all this. And what is that reason? Because of this COVID pandemic, a lot of liquidity has been generated by central banks all over the world, especially in the advanced economies like US, right? We have discussed this in a lot of sessions, that why stock markets are rallying and there is so much money in the stock markets, which is finding its way to emerging economies like India. So India is experiencing a huge inflow of funds. And if funds come into India, that appreciates Indian currency too much, which might have a bad impact on our exports. So that is why RBI needs to control that particular appreciation, right? So this is the logic, this is the reason RBI is giving. Surge of global liquidity added by global central banks led to huge strong inflows in emerging economies like India, preventing sudden appreciation in the rupee. To prevent the sudden appreciation, RBI had to put downward pressure by buying foreign exchange and selling Indian currency, right? So this is why India has been put on the list. Now, what are going to be the implications of this decision? See, nothing much is going to be done here because US is not like a regulator or something which is going to penalize us with any sort of punishment or these countries. But obviously, it affects the confidence of investors because they might think, okay, that particular country is engaging into something bad. They are doing currency manipulation. So that taints the image of the country in international markets, right? So here you can see that economy will remain on the, an economy, it remains on the monitoring list for at least two consecutive reports. So this is basically these reports that US makes out. So it an economy stays on this particular list till two reports come out. So they want to make sure that the country does not repeat all this. That is why they continue putting that country on the list and monitor them, right? So designation of a current country as a currency manipulator does not immediately attract any penalties, tend to hamper the confidence. Could face punitive measures by US as limited access to US government procurement contracts and to developmental finance. Obviously, US might put some restrictions, some trade restrictions or barriers in order to control this this surplus which is experienced by the other country or to reduce its own deficit, right? So US might put some, US might take some retaliatory actions, but many other countries like Vietnam has not accepted. The authorities of Vietnam, they have not replied or they have not accepted of doing this. They are saying that we are not indulging into manipulation, right? So we'll have to wait and see that what is going to happen ahead in this particular case, right? So guys, this was all about India being put up on the US watch list. I hope you learned something new from this video and this video helped you understand the topic better. If it did, then do not forget to hit the like button. And before I end the session, I would like to take a doubt. So there was an article which was mentioned by one of you in the comments. Just a second. So this article was on normalization. Okay, the article which was in Live Mint on 7th of December, this article was titled for RBI, the road to normalization may begin in financial year 22, right? See, this topic, this article talks about normalization. What is normalization? See, normalization talks about withdrawing the benefits that central bank gave to the industries in wake of the pandemic. So as you know that since this pandemic has erupted, RBI, the Central Bank of India, has come up with many incentives to drive growth in the economy. So this article says that RBI is now torn between, because see, inflation is growing, right? And in order to control inflation, they might want to increase the interest rates, but they cannot do it because that is going to have a bad impact on growth. And that is going to limit the access to credit for industries. So they have already provided so many measures that to control inflation, they might need to withdraw some of the benefits, right? Just as this article mentions about CRR being restored to 4% at the end of March 2021. So it depends upon RBI if they think that we still need growth and the growth which is erupting in the growth drivers which are visible in the economy, they are not stable, they might change and we need to stabilize them. In that case they might extend the benefits. But in order to control the inflation, see, once you provide the benefits, it's very difficult to take back. It's more like a slippery road. Once you start moving down on it, you tend to slip rather than come up, right? So it is just like a swing. It's very difficult to come back up. Once you start to slide, you slide down. Same goes for the central bank. If they start providing the benefits, if you remember about the topic of quantitative easing and tapering that we discussed in one section, right? So quantitative easing means providing the benefits, and then tapering means taking back those benefits, right? So it is very difficult for governments to taper it, because then the industries who get used to the benefits, they don't allow it. So RBI is trying to balance between growth and inflation, right? So that is normalization, taking back the benefits and leading the economy back to the normal cycle. Obviously, it does talk about the surplus liquidity that we have talked about in this session as well, that this surplus liquidity is making Indian rupee appreciate, right? So I hope this has helped you understand the article better, and I'll be back in next session with some more information. Till then, you guys take care of yourselves, take care of your studies, and I'll see you in the next session. Thank you for being here.